the kingdom of heaven. So if you're visiting with us today, or if you're new, we've been going through the Sermon on the Mount specifically and learning about the kingdom of heaven. We're exploring what happens when the kingdom of heaven comes to Edinburgh. We're discovering what Christianity could really look like in Scotland if we strip away our religious pride, we get rid of our own traditions that may not be biblical, we dig deep into the teachings of Jesus, and then we actually try to live it out in today's world, 2017. And what we believe and what we're finding as we go along is when we do this, by the grace of God, we won't have to wait for heaven. Now, heaven's going to be incredibly awesome, don't get me wrong, but we don't have to wait for heaven. All heaven will break loose now. In this city, in our neighborhoods, in our families, in our relationships with one another and with this community. Heaven will break loose when we live by the principles of the kingdom of heaven. Let's turn our Bibles to Matthew chapter 20. Matthew 20. Now, grace is the foundation. Grace is the foundation of the Christian life, of the kingdom lifestyle. Last weekend, several of you and my family as well, we went down to London. And there was a conference there that our family of churches had together. And the title of the conference for the whole weekend, the theme was His Grace. And it was a wonderful time. It was inspiring. And today I'm just going to throw to you some of the ideas I've stolen from the speeches I heard at that conference. I highly recommend that you hear the lesson that Paulo Ugolini did. I know I'm partial, because he's in Glasgow, and he's my partner in the gospel. But he did a magnificent lesson on grace and the ministry of Jesus. So I'll do my best to get that link out to you. All the lessons that were recorded are available online. But defining biblical grace, you see up on the screen here, it's this Greek word, charis. This means unmerited favor. Charity. It's a donation. Now, if we're looking at biblical, we're talking about biblical charis, grace. It's a donation out of the goodness of God's heart. That's what it is. And grace is a gift. For me, grace is the ability to draw my next breath. That's grace. Grace for me is to snuggle up with my children and my wife. That's a gift to me. Grace for me is to live in Edinburgh and be with you. American by birth, Scottish by the grace of God. I took out something that was offensive there that I heard at the conference. It's something like British. But I won't finish that. Okay, anyway, I'm proud. It's grace that I'm here with you.
Come on.
And to be loved by you. And just to explain this concept, we were brought here by grace, and the reason my family, that we're able to be here is for many, many years, you and other churches around the UK and Ireland have given missionary money in faith, not knowing what would happen with it. And from that money, there has been a commitment to us for 4 years that we can be missionaries here.
Amen.
And that's by God's grace.
Amen.
That's a donation to us, to our family. And I will tell you right now, if you're thinking, I can pay you back financially for that, I don't think I'm going to be able to do that in dollars or pounds or euros. All right, but because of that donation, I'm compelled. I feel I have an obligation to use this gift to help set you up, to set up the church for long-term success to the glory of God. chocolate here today. I'm feeling in a good mood. This is good stuff. I had to hide it. This is Cadbury. Yes. Stop it. You're not good at anything. But I have some to give away. Now, these are going to go to some special people, and hang with me on this. I'd like to know, help me think of this one. Who was the first to arrive today? How ironic it is. Who can attest to that? Was Nicola the first one here today? Was she here when you got here, Tanya?
She was here.
She was here. Wow, how these things work. You know, I just want to say to Nicola, because she was first today, and she is so many times. She works with Bethany Care Van. She spoke to us today, encouraged us. She does so much for the church, works with the children, has served us in so many ways. I want to give you this gift of chocolate to encourage you today. Spoken to our ushers. I wanted to know who the last person was to arrive. Everyone's just nervous right now. But I was told it was my good friend Gabriel was the last one. And you know what? I'm glad we're new friends now and that we were able to have a coffee together a few days ago. And I don't really care that you were the last today. I want to give you chocolate as well. Yeah. So, who's more deserving of the chocolate?
Nicola.
Jesus would answer this question. Matthew chapter 20, verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven, now let me stop there, for the Christian ethos, you could say, or the authentic Christian community, this is what it's like. It's like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire men to work in his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About the third hour, now that's about 9 a.m., coffee break time. About the third hour, verse 3, the landowner went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever's right." So they went. He went out again about the sixth hour and then the ninth hour and did the same thing. Verse 6, about the 11th hour, now that's near the very end of the workday, the 11th hour. The landowner went out and found still others standing around. He asked them, "Why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages. Beginning with the last ones hired, and then going on to the first." The workers who were hired about the 11th hour came, and each received a denarius. Verse 10. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. "These men who were hired last worked only 1 hour," they said, "and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day." But he answered one of them, "Friend, I am not being unfair to you. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the man who was hired last the same as I gave you. And don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. So verses 1 and 2. This is a landowner. He's a boss that's very unique. And notice it's not the site manager going out, but the owner himself, he goes out and he finds the needy people. This is God, the gracious landowner. That should be the title of this section in the Bible, the gracious landowner. So first thing in the morning, the landowner strikes a deal. He sets up a mutually agreed upon contract with these men to work in his vineyard for this one denarius. Then we go down to verses 3 and 5. Three more times, the gracious landowner takes the initiative. He finds the hungry, he finds the hopeless, and he hires them on the spot. Keep in mind, they are standing around. What are they doing? Nothing. No purpose. No better than anyone else. They're just lucky to be in the right place at the right time. And then we have this shocking twist to the story in verse 6. Just before closing time, the gracious landowner goes out one last time. And he finds more men standing around, and he hires them to work for him too. But not only that, when the work day ends, the men who worked the least get paid first. How's that sit with you? And not only that, the men who work the least get paid the same as the men that worked from the very beginning of the day, in the heat of the day. That's the upside down ethos of the kingdom of heaven. These are the scandalous mathematics of grace. And I borrow this sermon title from Philip Yancey's book, What's So Amazing About Grace? The scandalous mathematics of grace. God's maths simply do not add up to us. God's maths will feel very foreign to us. You see, in verses 8 through 12, everyone's very content with their job. Until it's time to pass out the rewards. Until it's time to give the paychecks. Up to that point, everyone was fine. Imagine your workplace if your boss used this salary model. Everyone gets paid the same here. No matter when you show up for work or how much you work, everyone's paid the same. And the guys who come later and work the least, I'm going to pay them first. You're going to get paid next week. Imagine that. Everyone was fine until the paychecks were handed out. You see, entitlement poisons the waters of grace. Grace is not enough. We want as much or more than someone else. Grumbling out loud about our situation. Passive-aggressive grumbling. Grumbling in our hearts. Hey, this is not fair. I've made lots of sacrifices. Look at him. I've had a hard life. Why is this not going this way for me? Why does he get that and I don't? What's in it for me? And what happens is we start looking around at our co-workers in the vineyard. And we get envious because God is so generous to them in our own eyes. Envious of the brother or sister in the church that gets recognition we feel we deserve. Maybe you can't relate to this, but I'm sharing things I can struggle with. You know, coveting that someone's married and you're not. Or jealous of the family that it seems God keeps blessing even though you feel like you've worked harder and longer than them. The poison of entitlement. Entitlement simply does not fit into the mathematics of God's grace. And the hero of the story, it's not the workers. The hero of the story is the landowner and his grace. That's the hero. The hero's not you and me. Extravagant generosity. This is shocking. This is what makes Christianity, I should say true Christianity, stick out from all the other brands and religions. This stunning example of the kingdom. I mean, God can even be accused here of being wasteful in his compassion, enabling in his compassion. I mean, he's the one that seeks these people out. These people aren't looking for him. In fact, like we said, they're standing around, they're doing nothing. And that's me. At age 27, at the uni, I was standing around doing nothing. I was talking a big game, but I had no spiritual purpose. I was doing everything for me and what worked for me, not for God. I wasn't doing anything for God. I mean, I could talk a good game about God, but the trajectory of my life proved that I was the only person that really cared about. I mean, I cared about myself, and that was about it. I wasn't looking for God. But God found me. And he gave me Jesus. And I've been thinking about that the last week. I'm no different. Think about your story, how you grew up. I'm no different than the people I grew up with in the neighborhood. Same small city. I'm no different than them. I'm not anything special compared to my friends that I went to university with. We all knew God existed, but we were too arrogant to learn from him or to learn from others. We were too proud to commit our lives to him. Had too many other things going, too self-centered to have any desire to work for him. So God, my story is God found me standing around, completely unaware of my need for him. And he saved me. For me, right place, right time. God's extravagant grace. And if you dig down deep, that's the testimony of every true Christian.
That's right.
Romans 3 teaches us no one seeks God. God always seeks us first. He's the initiator. He then gives us this abundance of undeserved grace. It's incredible. It's amazing. And how often we forget that, especially when it's time to get paid. God gives us, he gives us gifts, not wages. You don't want God to give you wages.
No.
We don't want that. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. We want gifts from God, not wages or what we think we deserve. You know, thank God none of us gets paid according to merit. I mean, no one comes to meeting God's requirements. No one comes to God sin-free and can negotiate with him. You know, once the water dries from our baptism into God's grace, all of us tend to gravitate to thinking we've been working for the Lord, earning our pay. All of a sudden, if I read this story, I think I'm the guy that showed up in the morning. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It could be like 6 months as a Christian, you're already like, I'm the guy that's, I came first in the morning. Right? And that's where we go to. But in reality, we're all 11th hour workers. That's the truth. In view of grace, we are all 11th hour workers. Just imagine if that really sunk in with us, how it would change our relationships and how we would interact with people outside this room. God gently but directly tells us in verse 13, friend, I'm not being unfair to you. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay, go. I want to give the man who was hired last the same as you. And don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last. My weakness is not a problem for God, but it is a problem for my pride. Quoting my friend Paulo. I have to tell him I actually quoted him on a big screen here. Like, what are you doing, man? But I love this. Really, my weakness is not, your weakness is not a problem for God. But it is a problem for your pride. Your weakness is a problem for your pride and my pride. You see, the Bible commands us in 2 Timothy 2:1, be strong in the grace. Be strong in the grace. So here's the key. If we're going to get stronger in the grace, we must become weaker in other areas. Here's what I mean. Stronger in the grace, weaker in our entitlement. Stronger in the grace, weaker in making excuses for ourselves. Stronger in the grace, weaker in complaining and grumbling. For me, I'm very, very good at reciting to others the details of my discouragements. I'm very good at finding people to blame. I'm very good at memorizing reasons to habitually complain about this or that. But how strong am I in counting my blessings? That's where I need to repent. It's a journey to continue to get there and to stay away from this mindset. I've been here since the morning. And I grumble against other people, grumble against God. No, I'm an 11th hour work here. I'm just lucky to be here. I am just blessed. I'm blessed to be here. How strong am I in expressing gratitude for others and the extravagant grace of God?
Amen.
If we're going to get stronger in the grace, we must get weaker in other areas. Pride will eat us alive with our weaknesses, to hide them. But God has no problem with our weaknesses. He wants to heal them and use them in wonderful ways. Paul, the apostle, writes in 1 Corinthians 15:9. Listen to this. We know, if you've been around for a while, you study Paul. Man, top shelf Christian. Best missionary you could ever dream of. I mean, I look at his life, I just can't always read him. I have to get away from Paul sometimes and just go to Peter. I relate to him a little better, you know? Peter made a lot of mistakes. He's like, Paul, you know, once he stopped killing Christians, he was pretty good. But anyway. But look what he writes here in verse 9 of 1 Corinthians 15. For I am the least of the apostles, and I don't even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God that lives in me. His grace was not without effect on Paul. His grace to me was not without effect. Can we say this in our lives right now? His grace to me was not without effect. Write that one down. Think about yourself in this one. Count your blessings. In other words, when you and I are strong in the grace, it will change the trajectory of our lives. Grace that has strong effects. You know, we read here 1 Corinthians 15. I'll just go down a list, and I can send these to you later. 1 Corinthians 15:10, grace energizes us to work hard for the Lord. Romans 6, God's grace inspires us to die to our sins with Jesus in baptism. Titus 2:12, grace teaches us to say no to lust and yes to self-control. In other words, grace teaches us to obey, even when we don't want to. 1 Peter 4:10, grace compels us to use our talents, our experiences to serve God and others, not our self-esteem. Ephesians 1, 2, and 3, grace ignites the power of prayer in our lives. We move beyond organ recitals. If you're at that midweek, you know what I'm talking about. Grace ignites the power of our prayer lives. In our prayer lives, so much more we rather than me. Prayer lives that are less me and more we, more dreaming with God that He will do more than we can ever ask for or imagine. But not just for ourselves, we dream for other people. We dream for other people in this room. We pray that the eyes of their heart will be open so they can see God and they can know that they have the power that lives in them, the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Grace will propel our prayers to change radically in this way. And as I said earlier, grace radically transforms the way we interact with our fellow human beings. And as we've been studying the Sermon on the Mount, seemingly impossible to obey this sermon, right? But God's grace, it's the supernatural fuel that helps us to live and breathe the commands of Jesus. Now check this out, John 1:16. Study this on your own later. John goes into his first chapter there in his apostle, in his gospel, and he's explaining that Jesus came full of truth and grace. And in verse 16, it says something profound. It says, from the fullness of his grace, we receive one blessing after another. From the fullness of his grace, we receive one blessing after another. And the meaning of fullness here, we can't always catch these things in English, but the meaning of fullness here is, it's this never-ending supply of grace. It just never runs out. And it's this supernatural irony that as long as we keep giving away grace, it will replenish itself. That's how it works. It never runs out as long as we keep giving it to people. God will continue to supply it for us. Because it's something that was meant to give away. God's grace leaves us no choice but to obey Matthew 10:8 that says, freely you have received. Now freely you must give. Amen. Let's think about that one here during Freshers Week. That's a scripture I need. Freely I've received, now freely I must give. The greatest gift we've been given is if we can honestly say this today. Look at my life. See my joy. His grace to me is not without effect. That's where we want to be. His grace to me was not without effect. No one can take that away from me. So as we prepare to remember Jesus in communion, let's reflect on these scandalous mathematics of grace that we directly benefit from. It benefits us. It happened at the cross. Because of our sin, Jesus received the wages we all deserve for our dirty work. He died for it. So as we remember the cross, let's lay aside our own jaded sense of fairness. Rather, let's all thank God that by his grace and generosity, we're blessed beyond measure. To say humbly, we are 11th hour workers. Praise God for that. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you for this time to remember Jesus, our hero, the one that took our place, the one that did the heavy lifting for each one of us. Help us look to him, and as we look around in our lives, whether it's here or at work or at school, wherever we go, strangers, that we look around and we're on level ground looking at the cross with every human being. Thank you, God, that you took away the cross that had our names on it, put your son there to die, that we might choose to love you back. Thanks for loving us on a mite. Thank you so much for Jesus. Help us to honor him. Just be full of joy in our lives, no matter what's going on in our lives. I pray for this church, for each one of us, that your grace is not without effect in our lives. We love you. We love you, Jesus. We pray all these things in your son's name. Amen.
Amen.